Hello, my dear students. Today I, Harshita Mishra, will teach you the remaining part of chapter number 1, that is reproduction in organism. So the today's topic will be sexual reproduction and events in sexual reproduction. So before coming to sexual reproduction in organism, let me define you what is sexual reproduction. See, when the two parents of opposite sex participates in reproduction process and it involves the fusion of male and the female gametes, it is called sexual reproduction. And sexual reproduction, what I have discussed here in points is that it is a kind of biological process which creates new organism by combining the genetic material of the two organisms. What here is the genetic material of the two organism means the genetic material of the male and the female. And this process, the sexual reproduction process, actually is done by a kind of a specialized division, meiosis. What you know about, there are two kind of the cell division taking place in a body, that is mitosis and meiosis. And mitosis is refers to as what? Equational division, in which the number of the cells remains the same, whereas in meiosis the number of the cells is reduced to half. And this meiosis is a specialized characteristic feature of sexual reproduction. And in this meiosis, meiosis takes place during this kind of reproduction, because meiosis takes place only in the germinal cells, in the reproductive cells, and it involves the it is involved in the sexual reproduction. Now come here the next point, in which I have discussed that each of the two parent organism, male and the female here, they'll contribute half of their genetic makeup to the new offspring. Means the half genetic makeup, the half genetic constituent will be from the male and the half will be from the female parent. With that, this all comes from where? This all comes from the haploid gametes, from the male and the female. And after coming, they makes the new offspring, which is actually diploid and consist of completely different genetic makeup from the parents. And the third point I have discussed here, that the sexually reproducing organisms have different sets of genes for every trait. Means they have different sets of genes for every trait here, means for every characteristic, the sexually reproducing organisms have different characteristics, and for those different characteristics they have different genes, like for height, for eye color, for the curl, straight and curled hair, for the skin color. These all are because of the different genes for the different characteristic in our body, which is also known as alleles. Now the offspring inherit one allele for each trait from each parent. Like here, the offspring which will obtain after sexual reproduction, it will inherit the characteristic of both the parents. Means it might have the gene or the gene for that trait, like for the height of its mother, whereas it may have the eyeball color of its mother. Okay, like for every trait, it might have some traits from its male parent and some traits from its female parent. Okay, and thus offspring have a combination of parent gene here. In all sexual reproduction, the offspring have a combination of its parent gene. This is all not been happening in the asexual reproduction. Here sexual reproduction has different phases. The sexual reproduction has been discussed in different phases, from where it starts and where it comes to an end. I guess I have earlier discussed all about the sexual reproduction phases in lifespan in my previous slide. But here also, let's see what is juvenile phase, what is reproductive phase, and what is senescence phase. So the juvenile phase is the phase during which an organism has reached to a certain stage, or the certain stage of growth or maturity, where they have become capable enough to reproduce here. Therefore this phase is refers to as juvenile phase in animals and vegetative phase in plants. This phase is of variable durations in depending upon the organism. It on the basis of duration, the organism may be different. Some organisms required some other kind of duration, and the other require some other kind of duration. So duration is different for juvenility in different organism. Now here is the reproductive phase. In during this phase, now the organism has elaborate and complex has reached to an elaborate and complex event, that is sexual reproduction, and it will reproduce sexually. And this sexual reproductive phase will be now divided into three distinct stages, that is pre-fertilization state, fertilization stage, and post-fertilization events. After reaching to this, after coming to the post-fertilization events, the phase it will reach will be the senescence phase, during which the end of the reproductive phase will be considered as one of the parameters of senescence or aging. Senescence means when all the vital activity, when the vital activities comes to an the drop of the level, when the level of activity, sexual activity drops, that is the here senescence phase or old age. Now here, before coming to the different events of sexual reproduction, it is very important to know the difference between asexual mode and sexual mode of reproduction. See here, the sexual mode of reproduction, the first point says that it does not involve the formation and the fusion of gametes and generally distinguished into male and female of gametes. And here it involves the formation and the fusion of the two gametes, that is male and female. And the second point is that the new individual develops from one cell or a vegetative body part of one parent. And here the new individual develops from the zygote or the fusion product of two gametes, which may or may not be produced by two parents. And the third point is that new individuals are genetically similar to the parents, but here in sexual reproduction they will not at all will be similar to their parents. They will differ from their either parents. And it involves only mitotic divisions, and it involves meiosis at one stage, and the higher plants meiosis occurs at the time of sporogenesis. We'll discuss about later in, I guess, in the chapter number 2. It does not require the formation of sex organs. Its formation of sex organ is a prerequisite condition for the sexual reproduction to take place. And in the sixth place, it does not introduce any kind of variability, so it does not at all involved in the evolution. Evolutionary importance, it does not contain any kind of evolutionary importance, whereas in sexual reproduction it has a variability as well as it plays an important and major role in the evolutionary importance. Now let's discuss about events in sexual reproduction. So the very first event that takes place during the sexual reproduction is that pre-fertilization event, which involves the two steps, that is gametogenesis, and the second one is the gamete transfer. Means in gametogenesis, first of all, pre-fertilization is the event that takes place prior to the fusion of gametes, that is included, and it includes in itself the two steps, that is gametogenesis and gamete transfer. And first of all, and the second step is the fertilization, during which syngamy and fusion of the gametes takes place to form a diploid zygote. And the very last step is the post fertilization, means after the zygote has been developed, it will go under some changes, means embryogenesis will take place. After the formation of zygote will convert into the embryo, and that embryo formation is known as embryogenesis. We'll discuss all about these events in detail in our next slide. So very first event, that is pre-fertilization, and the very first step of pre-fertilization is the gametogenesis. And it is what gametogenesis is. Gametogenesis is the process of formation of two types of gametes. What are those two types of gametes? That are male and female. And these gametes are actually haploid cells. And on the basis of their structure, on the basis of their appearance, they are of two types, homogametes and heterogametes. Homogametes may be isogametes also, in which the two gametes appears to be similar in appearance, cannot categorize them into male and female gametes. Like in some algae, you can see that you cannot categorize whether whether gamete is of female or of the male. So those types of gametes are referred to as homogametes, which is similar in appearance. And now comes here heterogametes. Heterogametes are those gametes which are morphologically distinct gametes for male and male gametes. Like in bryophytes, we can find the male gametes known as anthrozoites and are structurally different from that of the female gamete, which is egg or the ovum. And then also similarly can also be seen in the human beings, that is male and female. The structurally they are very much different, and appearance wise also they are very much different, which is sperm and the ovum. Here in the figure you can see this is the homogametes. This is homogametes in some kind of algae it is found, which there you can see they are structurally similar. Here you cannot distinguish which one is male and gamete and other one is female gamete. You cannot distinguish between male and the female gamete. This is why these are known as homogametes, similar in their appearance. And the other one is the figure of heterogametes. This is the figure of egg or the ovum, and another is the figure of the male gamete, which is known as sperm or the anthrozoites in bryophytes. In fungi and plants, it has also been observed there are some homothallic and monoecious terms being used to denote a kind of condition known as bisexual condition. And heterothallic and dioecious are generally used for unisexual condition. In flowering plants, unisexual flowers, means male flower is termed as staminate, that is they're bearing stems. And the other, those of the unisexual female flowers, says to be the pistillate, means they're bearing the pistils, means the male and the female bearing parts of the plant, and refers to as staminate, and the those of the females is refers to as pistillate. Okay, they have separate body to carry the male and the female part of the flowers. In animal species, when both the male and the female reproductive organs are present in the same individuals, they are called bisexual or hermaphrodite. When you have all, I guess you are familiar with the terms bisexual and hermaphrodite, and in generally can be seen in some animal species, they are generally having both the male and the female reproductive organs in some individuals, and has been observed in some phylums like in Esculentes, it has been observed, and it has been observed in cylindrates. It has been observed in Platyhelminthes phylum, and here I have given the examples of some animal species like organisms like earthworms, sponges, tapeworm, etc. These are the organisms, they are bisexual in nature. And now there are some animal species which is having separate male and the female reproductive organs, which are known as unisexual. Now the term is, I guess term is clear, bisexual and unisexual. Now unisexual are what we are. We are what? Unisexual kind of organism. Means the female reproductive organs are different from those of the male reproductive organs. And examples are also given here of cockroaches, means cockroaches comes under which phylum? This comes under, let me tell you this, they comes under arthropods. Arthropods and human beings, mammalia. These are the species which is having the unisexual condition. Now gametes are, earlier told you that gametes are always haploid, and they contain half set of chromosome in the male and the half set of the chromosome in the other. There are some algae, the lower plants, you can say, the lower organisms, lower level of organisms like algae, fungi and bryophytes, they have haploid plant body. As we follow the evolutionary trend from algae to the angiosperms, I have already discussed, I guess, in the plant kingdom all about these. So as you know that when we go from the smaller plants, like from the algae, from the lower level organization to high level of organization, you will find that there comes a difference in the plant body also. They become, from the lower level to high level, if you go, they'll convert from haploid to diploid. Like algae, fungi and bryo, they'll always have haploid plant bodies, and pterido, gemino and angiosperms and most of the animals are what? Diploid. Now comes here, what is gamete transfer? This is the second step of pre-fertilization. In this, the majority of the organisms, male gametes are motile and female gametes are non-motile. Means motile means ki mobility. Means ki male gametes are always find to be movable, means they have kind of movement, whereas female gametes are found to be, most of the time they are found to be non-motile, having no movement. And but there are some exceptions and some exceptions like here fungi and algae, in which we can find that both the gametes are having motility. The simplest kind of second point says that the simplest kinds of plants like algae, fungi, bryo and teredo, they require some kind of medium for the gametes to be transferred. So that medium, what will be that medium, like that medium will be kind of water. That's why they generally requires water for their reproduction to take place, for the gamete, for the male gamete to transfer, or the male female gamete to come into the contact with the male gamete. So water will be the medium of their fusion. Water will be the medium that will allow the male gamete and the female gametes to come close and association, and in after that their gamete will comes to fuse. And in the higher plants, what happens, how does gamete transfer takes place? This gamete transfer takes place by pollination. And what is this pollination? This pollination is actually, in the previous slide you have came to know the staminate and pistillate flowers, male and the female flowers. And those male and the female flowers, what they contain? Male flowers contains anthers, and female plant contains stigma. What is stigma? Stigma is that receptive organ that will receive the anther. Anther is your pollen grain, and that anther, when it will come from when it will come from one plant and it will land to the stigma of another flower, it will create what? Pollination. And that pollination will lead that gamete, anther means what, this is pollen or anther, you can call the same thing, will take your pollen to the female reproductive part. Means the here, what is the medium? Here the medium of gamete transfer in the higher plant is pollination, and those in the simplest kind of plant is the water is the medium for the gamete transfer. This is all, I guess, you have came to know about gamete transfer. There is no confusion at all in this gamete transfer.
So after pre-fertilization event, that is gametogenesis and gamete transfer, we'll discuss later about the fertilization and post-fertilization in my next video.